Good evening, I'm Father Dave McAllen. Tonight we'll have our final edition of the Best of Reel to Reel.
We'll warm up with a visit to the shore accompanied by a courageous group of children.
We'll reopen the doors to a private world through our exclusive series on life in the cloister. And we'll hear from two of our popular regulars, psychiatrist Dr. Richard Fitzgibbons and critic Michael Gallagher.
And I'm Isabel Gauvry-LaGrosse. Welcome to Reel to Reel.
Good evening. We're happy to have you with us here on Reel to Reel. Tonight, we're going to continue to look back at some of the best stories we've produced over this past year.
Working on Reel to Reel gives us the opportunity to meet so many great people, many of whom certainly merit a second look.
One such group is the Lions Club of Stone Harbor, New Jersey, an outstanding organization that has a wonderful program at the shore.
Sand, surf, and sunshine, the sights and sounds of summer. But suppose that this was how you had to experience the seashore. This is reality for blind children. Children playing in this baseball game are all either totally or legally blind. They are guests of the Helen, Diller Vacation Home for Blind Children, sponsored by the Lions Club of Stone Harbor, New Jersey. Every week during the summer, 20 blind youngsters visit the home located in Avalon, New Jersey. Here, under the supervision and guidance of a trained and caring staff, the youngsters enjoy all the same joys of summer as do sighted children.
Late in 1960, one of our charter members, Harry E. Arader, saw two twin boys playing on the beach in Avalon. One of those young men, whose name is Justin McDevitt, I'll tell you about him later, was quite instrumental in the founding of the home. Mr. Arader came back to the club and appointed a committee to research the possibility of finding a home along the seashore so that the Stone Harbor Lions Club could provide summer recreational activities for blind children. In order to get the home funded, a committee was formed, and three of the Lions members went to a bank to borrow $50,000. Those three men had to put up their properties as collateral to the bank to borrow the $50,000. It was memorialized in Mrs. Diller's honor, known as the Helen L. Diller Vacation Home for Blind Children. Mr. Diller Sr. saw fit to make a considerable donation to the home, and in retrospect, we memorialized the home in her honor. The cost to operate the home is approximately $100,000 a year. The monies are generated through donations of all of the Lions Clubs in the state of New Jersey, some from Pennsylvania, the private sector, raffles, the general community at large. It's a wonderful experience because it is a community project represented by the community and for young people.
We accompanied the children on one of the most popular trips of their stay to Wonderland Amusement Pier in Ocean City, where all ride tickets are donated by Lions Club member Jerry Sumner. And as you'll see, it wasn't easy keeping up with this group.
Whoa!
come aboard the fishing boat Captain Kramer, where skipper Don Kramer takes time out each week from his charter fishing business to give the children the once-in-a-lifetime experience of reeling in the big one. And what was the captain's opinion of the day's catch?
That's fishing. Some days it's real good and other days it's not so good.
A highlight of the children's visit is their trip to Zaber's restaurant, a North Wildwood tradition. Dinner is on the house, courtesy of owners Ed and Ane Zaberer. On this occasion, the children, accompanied by Diller Home President William Diller, presented the Zaberers with a letter written in Braille expressing their thanks to Ed and Ane for years of service to the home.
From the very beginning and the inception of the blind home.
The reward for being involved in this project over a decade, I can sum it up real quickly. But I want to go back to Justin McDevitt, who gave us the thought to go ahead with this. And then, some 10 years later, was one of the 11 people, disadvantaged people, that climbed Mount Rainier. No one person can be responsible for all of this or take credit for it. We do it because we want to do it. We do it according to the lion's toast, not above you, not beneath you, but with you. People who help people are the happiest people in the world.
Seeing all that glorious sunshine certainly makes you long for the endless days of summer, but the dedication of the people involved with the Helen Diller home is enough to keep you warm all year long.
And if that doesn't do the trick, maybe a cup of warm hot chocolate will help out. We're going to break now, but when we come back, we're going to take a look again behind the doors of a cloistered convent. Last season, Sean Hughes Camp, the former hostess of Reel to Reel, narrated a four-part series on women who enter the contemplative life.
This special series was part of what helped us to win a Cappy Award given by the New Jersey Cable Network last fall.
We were delighted to accept the award for the best produced religious program by an out-of-state producer. I think you'll agree with the judges.
Come from a multitude of exotic, faraway places to live their entire adult life in seclusion here in the Philadelphia area. A life with a steady regimen of devotion, a lifestyle in which each day is like the one before. They chose to forsake their homes in Japan, France, Germany, Ireland, the Philippines, and Mexico, in order to live a tight communal life with women from closer locales, such as New Jersey, Delaware, and New York. Their days are spent in peaceful prayer and quiet dedication, as well as in hours of hard work. It is widely known that the livelihood of cloistered orders depends to a certain extent on the donations of family, friends, and from people they will never meet. So to ease the financial pressures, the sisters try to live as self-sufficiently as they possibly can. Each sister has a designated job to do each day. Sister Mary Patricia makes the habits worn by the Sisters of Jesus Crucified. Sister Winfrieda has had the job of sacristan at the Convent of Divine Love for the past 10 years. Sister Francine and me is seen here caring for the physical appearance of the Visitation Sisters' property. Sister Evelyn answers the phone and greets visitors to the Poor Clare Monastery, which earns her the title of portress. And how would you like to prepare 3 meals a day for over 20 women? That's what Sister Alphonsus and Sister Mary Carroll must do as the cooks for their communities. If the monastery has available ground space, the sisters will often use this land to grow some of their own vegetables.
This real.
And each community must spend time processing the correspondence they receive daily. Even still, many contemplative orders worldwide are forced to earn income for the community in some other fashion in order to make ends meet. For this reason, the Poor Clares and Langhorne put into operation a hectic altar bread business. Annual production for the monastery exceeds 7 million hosts, which are then distributed to area churches. Here you see Sister Mary Frances preparing the batter, which is a simple mixture of flour and water. Sister Mary Thomas pours the batter onto a smooth, hot stove, which presses and bakes it. After the wafers are humidified for 18 hours, the bread is cut by Sister Mary Constance into the round hosts that will be consecrated during the celebration of the Mass. The Sisters of Jesus Crucified have opted for a much different line of work, and hardly one you would attribute to a cloistered community. The Sisters operate a cytology laboratory where they execute tests such as pap smears for local doctors who have relied on the Sisters' lab analysis for over 20 years. All the sisters who work in the lab are registered cytotechnologists, and a few, like Sister Mary Zita, even have bachelor degrees in biology. What do you like most about your life here?
I think probably the greatest thing that's happened to me is the exposure to many, many things and many people that I probably would never have met or come into contact with had I continued on my little path in Minnesota.
I like just about everything that composes our life. The fact that we do live as a family, the fact that we enjoy each other, the fact that we pray together, and that we also have time for prayer in our own private ways.
There's a great deal of freedom in it, to really do what you want to do, what you're really called to do. It's one of the few luxuries we have in this world that a lot of people are cheated out of in many ways because they're so taken by other things.
Just to be in the choir and to be peaceful with God, not necessarily thinking about anything, but just centering your whole eyes on the tabernacle, I find that's the greatest thing for me.
How long did it take you to adapt to a contemplative lifestyle?
I felt that I adjusted, I don't know if everyone would agree, but I felt that I adjusted very easily, because I guess because I was young, and we were very busy in those days, much busier than now. So I didn't have enough time to think, really, in a way. We just kept there was a lot of difference in the life, and I think that appealed to the romanticism that a young person has. The life here was so different. So I enjoyed what some people would seem that would be a difficult adjustment. I felt that it was sort of like a challenge.
I wanted it so much that when I got there, all I could think of was, I hope they'll keep me,
Well, at first it wasn't an easy adjustment because the silence just was too much for me. By nature, I tend to be a bit of a practical joker. And in fact, there was another young girl who was here with me at the time, and she and I were the practical jokers of the bunch. The only problem is she got caught, but I didn't. And unfortunately, she was asked to leave because they didn't think she could take it. Well, this wasn't meant to be a carnival, as they told her.
Only one night.
Why only one night?
Because when I entered, I felt I came home.
Do you ever have any regrets?
No. There certainly were a few days when, you wish you would have said yes to George 20 years ago. But
is there anything you miss from your former life?
I would just say mostly the people I knew and loved at home, my family, a few close friends. It's mostly the holiday seasons when you miss them, you know, the times are really family-oriented, like Thanksgiving, Christmas. I also miss sports quite a bit. I love tennis, and I love bicycle riding, and of course I can't do that here.
Well, I'll be real honest with you. Cokes.
Do you think that your prayers are for the whole world, and do you think they have any effect?
I'm convinced that prayer is my best service of love that I can offer God and the world. And the more I see it, it's what the world needs.
Yes, I'm really convinced of that. And I'm more and more convinced that our lifestyle is needed when I hear what is going on out there, how the people, the evil that's going on. I can see whether our prayer life is necessary to obtain graces and gifts for these people who need to be converted and turned around to become better.
Because of God's presence everywhere and his presence to us and ours to him, I feel that our prayerful influence is universal. And I even, when I pray, I like to say, if there are any rational creatures on other planets, Lord, include them too and bless them and have them love you, you know.
It really was a privilege to witness the devotion and surprising joy of the contemplative vocation. And it is comforting to know that there are people in the world who are responding in a very literal sense to St. Paul's admonition to pray always.
So let's remember to keep the sisters in our prayers from time to time in support of the beautiful work that they do. We're going to break now, but coming up we have two of your favorite regulars. So stay with us. Mike Gallagher of the United States Catholic Conference has a film review column syndicated nationwide. We're fortunate to have him join us here in our Philadelphia studio to keep us abreast of current films.
In this next piece, we'll see Mike at his crusty old finest as he discusses the film industry's new PG-13 rating.
Unless you just returned from a prolonged sojourn in the Himalayas, you must have heard about the PG-13 rating by now. The Motion Picture Association of America, in its wisdom, bestowed it upon the parents of America in July, and just in the nick of time. For the violence of Indiana Jones and Gremlins, both rated PG, had stirred such a public outcry that the old bogey of censorship seemed to be looming up again, and the film industry felt that some gesture was imperative. Now, unlike R, the PG-13 entails no age restriction at the box office, and it carries a sterner warning than the PG, to wit. Parents are strongly cautioned to give special guidance to children under 13. Some material may be inappropriate for young children. The MPAA contends that the PG-13 will make life easier for you parents by by picking the stronger stuff out of the great grab bag of PG and labeling it as such. If this indeed were the only effect of this bit of fine tuning, it might be a step, however small, in the right direction. But if any short-term benefit does indeed accrue to parents, I'm afraid that it will be greatly outweighed by the problems that the PG-13 will soon give rise to. If you were worried before about what your child might run into in a non-restricted movie, you have far greater cause to worry now. But it's only a matter of time before ingenious movie makers will find the means to get yet stronger violence, yet steamier sex out of the R and into the congenial niche of PG-13. PG-13, in fact, might well become the preferred rating for movie makers bent on exploitation. It would become a signal to teenagers, and pre-teenagers too, that this movie has some good stuff in it, and you don't have to worry about being turned away at the box office. What's to be done? Two things. First, you can write your elected representatives in Congress, urging them to put pressure upon Hollywood to stop thinking in terms of what's good for the film industry is good for America. The PG-13 decision, for example, was made without any consultation with outside groups, educational, religious, or scientific. Secondly, and this is more important, like it or not, parents have to become quasi-experts in this field. You can't depend wholly upon ratings, even those put out by the U.S. Catholic Conference, in which I happen to be involved. The USCC classifications, unlike the expediency-attuned MPAA ratings, are based upon moral and aesthetic judgments. But still, no classifications can take the place of a good review which cites chapter and verse. If you're dealing with a teenager who quite properly is developing a mind of his or her own, you've got to be able to do more than lay a classification on the table. Now, even a bad movie review can be better than none at all. For the critic, unless he is totally hopeless, and quite a few are, I admit, he'll usually give you some idea of what the movie is about. Get to know your local critics then, and get to know their idiosyncrasies too. Then go to a movie once in a while to find out what adjustments you have to make. Finally, I offer this in due modesty. You can listen to what I have to say here. Naturally, I have no idiosyncrasies that have to be checked out. Is all this a lot of work? You bet your life it's a lot of work. But it's also a lot of work for a mother to feed her children a healthy, balanced diet. And popular entertainment, for good or ill, can affect the spirit as much as food does the body. I'm Mike Gallagher for Arts Review.
You know, Father, I like Mike's analogy of putting as much effort into your children's viewing habits as you do into their eating habits.
And it's nice to know at least one person with no idiosyncrasies. In this coming segment, for those of us who are mere humans, Dr. Richard Fitzgibbons has some helpful advice on handling anger.
Anger is an emotion which is totally out of control in our country. I'm Dr. Richard Fitzgibbons, and I'm going to be speaking with you today about the emotion of anger, which in my clinical experience is the single major obstacle in loving relationships in every life state, married, religious, and single. This is an emotion which can enter early in life, be buried and denied, and emerge many years or decades later and be misdirected at people who really don't deserve it. And many people do this without even realizing it. There are three things we can do with the emotion of anger. We can deny this emotion, we can express it, and we can express it in one of two ways. We can express it by being very honest and saying, gee, you've disappointed me, you've hurt me, and I don't like it. Or we can express it in a passive-aggressive way. That is, a way in which people pretend that they're not angry, when in fact they are very angry. And they express this anger by not doing things, by not loving, by not being on time, by not working the way they're meant to work, and they pretend always that they're not angry. The third thing we can do with anger is to forgive. This is not first prayer. It is first a decision that you make in your mind to give up your anger. This is the only way that anger leaves you. Expressing anger doesn't free you from anger. Because you see, the problem is most of us deny so much anger growing up without realizing it, that when we move to express anger, we overreact, so that only in forgiving are we really freed from our anger. Now, if we fail to forgive on a daily basis, we can be doing significant emotional and physical damage to ourselves. There was a recent study of the employees of Western Electric in Chicago that showed that very angry employees had 6 times more coronary artery disease than those who had low levels of anger. Forgiveness has untold benefits for us. It resolves depressive episodes, it resolves fear, it helps us forget, it makes for a more peaceful home. I want to strongly suggest to you that you not let the sun go down on your anger, that you not go to bed at night denying anger or expressing anger, but that you try to let go of that anger by forgiving. You're going to make your home much more peaceful and the very society in which we live a more peaceful and loving society. This is Dr. Richard Fitzgibbons.
It's good to remember positive and creative alternatives to storing up anger and to realize that peace in the world begins at home.
We hope you've enjoyed this look at the best of Reel to Reel. Please take a moment to let us hear from you, especially if there are some segments that you'd like to see again in the future. We plan to bring you our most popular pieces from time to time.
You can write us here at Reel to Reel, room 907, 222 North 17th Street, Philadelphia, PA, 19103. And be sure to be with us next week when we have a crosstalk segment on Catholic education.
Thank you for joining us this evening. Good night.
Good night. And remember, Jesus is Lord.